calls me to leave, child, my happy home. But someday, baby, you ain't worried my life anymore.
I love racing, first of all. I'll race anything, if just give me a chance. And one day while I was at the service station working, a gentleman by the name of Bruce Myers walked in and he says, I know you do a lot of racing with Jeeps and you've been successful. How would you like to race a Myers Manx? I said, what is that? I had no idea what a Myers Manx was. And it was a Volkswagen powered fiberglass dune buggy. And he said, well, there's a big race coming up and there's going to be some people here to talk about it by the name of Ed Perlman. And we would like to have you come to the meeting and talk about putting on this race in Mexico, because Bruce Myers had already set a record for that event by himself with Ted Mangels. And now they're going to talk about trying to put it together and sponsor it as a major event. So long story short, we all got together at a restaurant in Orange County and planned this off-road event called the Baja 1000. And the rest is kind of history.
It was supposed to start in a hotel in Tijuana. But when they got there and all the cars came in, it was like, we don't have room for all these cars. The parking lot's way too small. So Dad and Don Francisco got up in his airplane And they're looking for a big field or something for to start. And they flew over the bull ring. That's a good spot. So they went there. The gate wasn't locked. And they went in. Told all the cars, go to the bull ring. Everybody, go to the bull ring. So they went to the bull ring. The owner came over and said, what are you guys doing here? Well, we're starting an event. Okay. Somehow they got through it. That's where it started.
Ted Bangles are as well prepared for the race as any team can be, but the unpredictable road to La Paz can change the odds for anyone at any time.
Just a bat in a cave, I'm trying to behave, but there's so much blood and so many veins, I can't wait for the sun to sink again. I'm just a hunting, feeding, drinking my life away. I'm hanging upside down, I'm coming to your town. I'm gonna drink you dry, I'm gonna make you cry. I'm gonna have my fill and all fly. I'm just a hunting, beating, drinking my life away.
On the road 27 hours and 38 minutes, and that is a new record by almost 3.5 hours.
You really don't know. You do know, but you don't emotionally and mentally. You're so tired that it's hard to get, for me it was anyway, hard to get really up about the finish line. And I guess the only reason you know it's the finish line is there's a lot of people standing around, and there's people, there's Spanish people down there playing guitars and trumpets and all that kind of stuff. I had good luck driving, and I think there was some driver involvement in that as far as making it, because I drove 90% of their event. Ted Mangles, who rode with me that year also, was my navigator, and he was good because he'd already been down there with Bruce, so he knew the road, knew the area. I had done a little pre-running prior to that, but other than that, it was Ted Mangles that really told the story as far as where I was supposed to go. It was up to me to make the car go there and come out in first place. I can't even begin to compare today's off-road racing and the hoopla behind the whole scene with the drivers and the driving suits. And I wore a quilted, zipped-up jacket. And I had an old bandana on my face because I had to keep the dust out, and an old helmet. And it's just, it's the contrast between today and the flashy suits and the million-dollar cars. And then the biggest thing is there's a helicopter following you and telling you what to do. I had a bottle of scotch in my car, and that was my backup. And if we broke, I was going to sit there and drink. And that's exactly what I would do. So I can't even begin to compare today as it was in our day, because it was survival in our day, totally survival. And I have a map that was given to me. It was an automobile club map. It was the only race course direction I had. And Perlman had laid out on it with a felt tip the course we were going to take, 1,000 miles. With an auto club map.
First of all, my mother, as a baby, as soon as I can remember, she said, "Oh, Brucey, you're a dreamer." I'm a dreamer. I dream and I dream and I dream. All my life I dreamed, and my mom kept saying, you're a dreamer. Well, so okay. I don't dream about making money at the other end of my dream. It's always about some experience, I guess. So here I am today. I seem to have been the first of so many things, like the first of the Volkswagen Dune Buggy. I'm inspired by a few handmade buggies. When I saw these dune buggies running around, handmade ones, that is, in the sand dunes and at Pismo Beach and such places, that's what made me say those things ought to be made out of fiberglass, because the fiberglass gives it the ability to make sculptural shapes that you can't do with metal. A fiberglass can be made in a matter of hours. That is the body. It can be actually bolted together in a matter of days. So you've shortened it from months, weeks, and days to maybe days, hours, and minutes. And that was what made it durable, affordable, and desirable, because I brought a artistic bent to it. Well, the fun part of it was the main thing that drove the whole business. The bigger thing that I touched was off-road racing. The first race was organized. We started NORUN, National Off-Road Racing Association. The president was Ed Perlman. The very first record in Baja with the four wheels was a car. It was a Myers-Banks, one of my buggies. Race the following several months later was a Myers-Banks, Vic Wilson, and then another Myers-Banks. So the very first four automobiles in the history of off-road racing were all Myers-Bankses. You know, when we first arrived at the first race, there's a bunch of four-wheel drive guys, you know, Broncos and Jeeps and all that stuff. And they said, where the hell do you think you're going with them goddamn things? And, well, we're sorry. We're just here to play, have some fun. All those four-wheel drives broke. They were sprinkled all over the Baja Peninsula because they're heavy. And the people driving them, they were so in love with their four-wheel drivers that they just had no sense of the fact that a Volkswagen has a trailing arm suspension. It's really quite harmless. You can just beat the crap out of it. And the car was light. We weighed half the weight of a Jeep, and we went the same speeds. You know, you don't go more than 50 or 60 miles an hour most of the time. The Jeep was not the right car, but they thought it was. Well, I wanted to show them what the hell the car would do. They had no clue that it would just climb cliffs, you know?
I guess it gives people a chance to have an adventure. I think that's really what it's all about. If you don't have an adventure in life, don't go to your grave without an adventure of some kind.
The Manx buggies came in, chopped Volkswagen sedans were around at that time. People would take a stock Volkswagen sedan and take a torch and cut all the extra metal off the front end, leave the gas tank, and chop the fenders off, go to the back end and remove everything up to the front firewall, and you had a motor hanging on it, and it got along well. You had doors, you had windows, you could go where you wanted to go, but they were pretty ugly. Two of the guys that worked for Bruce when he was building molds, San Havens and Drino Miller, they developed out the fiberglass Baja Bug kit after they had been down to Chick Iverson Volkswagen, were invited down there by Gary Emery, who built the first classic looking Baja Bug out of all metal parts, he and his dad and his brother. His dad was a body guy that couldn't be believed. His brother was a painter that none ever matched. And Gary says, I know where I can get parts to go on that. She made me shake in the knees. 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 She made me shake in the knees.
I wanted a Myers Manx, but I got to thinking about it. I already had two kids. I want to be able to just jump in my car, my buggy, go camping. And if I take a car that's a stock chassis and cut 14 and a half inches out of it, you know, there's not any hardly any room for camping stuff, let alone two daughters, you know. So I told my dad, I said, you know, if I just had not so much overhang front and back and bigger tires, I don't know why I couldn't go most of the places they go, you know. So I got it. Dad said, get it up to where you kind of want the stance of it with the tires you want on it. And then we'll just bob it. That's what he said. We'll just bob the front and back in. So Dad says, first thing, and of course he's a body shop manager at the dealership. So he says, we're just going to use four front fenders. I said, why four front? He says, because if we take a front fender and turn it around backwards, now it's wide. Instead of being narrow, now it's a wide fender. I think early 69 when I actually got it done. And I loaded up to go to this race. My two kids, a VW slat roof rack on the top with my tent, you know, all of our clothes and pillows and ice chests and everything on the car. And we drove up and drove to the pits for the 1000 race. Bruce Myers and all those guys were all there lined up. And I pulled up and pulled down into the wash there and parked about 200 feet away, pulled up, kids jumped out, I jump out, I instantly set up a tent, table, chairs, all that stuff. And Bruce just went, because I never really told him, and I'm sure that Drino and Sanford never said anything to him. No, I know he never saw the car or knew anything, hadn't heard anything about it until it was done, you know. So that's all out for how it came, started with me.
The thing, the impact of that yellow car with those big tires and those Anson wheels and that exhaust system, I must have spent half hour or more walking around and looking at it and just scratching my head and saying, what the heck is this? It's just pure genius. Then after a while, it came to me, this is pure genius. Instead of building a Myers Manx, I could build something like this right now and cheap.
1974, the management of Baja Racing changed hands. Noted off-road racer Mickey Thompson asked magazine publisher Sal Fish to join forces and form an organization called SCORE, Short Course Off-Road Events. They would take Baja off-road racing into the future.
Wanted me to be involved and become the president of the company because of my publishing background and my love for Baja, because at that time I was competing in the Baja 500 race and the Baja 1000 races. It took him about 9 months to convince me that I should leave my position as publisher of Hot Rod Magazine and get involved with SCORE International.
By 1974, racing in Baja had become very professional and very fast. There were many classes, from motorcycles and dune buggies to mini trucks and full-sized pickups. There were specialty vehicles bred just for off-road racing, typified by the strong truck used by four-time Baja champion Walker Evans. The Baja racers were maturing rapidly, from backyard buggies to super-fast race cars.
Just like any other sport, I think the sport of off-road racing has had a great evolution in the last 20 years. I like to compare it to the first off-road race that I know about, and that was the pioneers coming from the East Coast to the West Coast in the covered wagons, and look what they did it with. And that's about what the poor guys that did it 20 years ago were using. No suspension, tires were completely different, their own physical stamina was different, it was just a will and a desire to do something unique.
For a long, long, many years, the most entries were all a Volkswagen of some form. The engine, the chassis, the modification, whatever. That was really what started this whole thing. Bug, let's face it, revolutionized the industry, the auto industry, it really did. But the fact that you turn a bug into a race machine is unbelievable. Thinking that you're going to take a stock VW bug and turn it into a vehicle that's going to go 1,000 miles off-road is, you've got to be demented to have that thought. And it worked, though.
And the day I see the in television, the first Baja 1000, and I get hooked. I was racing stock car. I sold the cars, everything. I raced nothing but off-road racing. Because race off-road in the desert is a lot, it's not like the driving the oval track. You got to go up the hill, down the hill, and the thin, the sand, and the ground, and the change, everything, the terrain change. Right, and you gotta learn how to read the terrain. Not many people go and pre-run the Baja 1000 to La Paz, you know, to know the course. I did it. The first race I won because in the desert is because I go slow. Before, I spent 10 years in over in crashing, rollover, breaking cars like crazy. You know, and never win. But one time, I owe the rent in my house, the electricity, the gas, I owe everything. I had to make some money. And I go slow. Well, don't break the car. And I won the 500 to 50. And that time, they give me $2,600, was a lot of money. I can pay all my bills. But I say, oh, that's the way you gotta drive a road. You gotta be in your pace. In the short course, no matter. Short course, you gotta go the fastest you can go. Nicky Thompson coming one day to Bashar Pepe, we're gonna have a new class. What class? Class 11. Gonna be in a stock car with a winch and everything. The first race gonna be Riverside. The race in Riverside, the big race. The class 11. They advertise, they got Walker Evert, Parnelli John, Nicky Thompson, everybody racing class 11 to advertise. They got 44 class 11 in the stadium. They broke fenders, bumpers, jet, everything. And this is why Nicky started the class, class 11.
Back in 1975, my dad gave me a Volkswagen. He told me, you want it? I told him, yeah. He told me, well, if you fix it, it's yours. So I fixed the puck. I love to race them, you know, and they still race the same cars. You know, I remember when I was a kid, Daniel Rosette Vampiro. But, he was one of the guys who started up, you know, telling me about bucks. Because of him, you know, I started up. That's what I've been doing for the past 31 years. And I enjoy it. I'm 61 and I still want to race. I don't know when I'm going to get tired. My wife tells me, sell the race, at least sell one of the race cars and we go to Europe. I tell no. And then my wife asks me, why do you work on the car all day, every day? When it gets to a race, we, I come here to the house at 12, 1 o'clock, and then I wake up at 3 in the morning to go to work. So it's hard, but it's life. If you want to go racing, you know, you have to pay the price. You know, a lot of people hit race all their lives and they have never accomplished one win. Believe it or not.
Well, I'll tell you, the Baja Bugs were born in the desert, raised in the desert, and I guess it shouldn't surprise us that they are doing a real good job out here in the desert today.
Trouble don't come along. Bad things happening through the years. all free and clear.
My brother, we would compete against each other, we raced with each other, and then my son got involved, and then so we broke off with my brother a bit, and now it's all three of us together. You know, it's my older brother and my son, and it's awesome. I don't know, it's just like I said, it's the family. And now his son Ernie Jr. is into it too, you know, so it's like the two Ernies, the two Larrys, and all the cousins and everybody. It's just that's it, man. Like, that's what's bringing me back, you know, like the kids, the freshies, they're coming out, and I want to show them what I've learned over the years, and now they're showing me, like, no, Dad, you don't do it like this, you got to do this. It's just a big familia, you know? You know, all our co-pilots, everybody is involved, man, you know? In some way or another, whether it's like taking the tires down or a sponsorship, or it's just, it's family, man, and you need to have a good family to be out in the desert. It's just, that's what I love.
Ever since I was a kid, I wanted to drive one, I wanted to race one, I wanted to be like my dad. I was always in the back of his truck with the 5-gallon jug, the water jugs. I would flip them upside down, pretend that was a steering wheel, and I would just, you know, play in the back of the truck, pretending I was driving a Baja Bug. And I grew up, co-piloted a few times, and that's when I really knew this was what I wanted to do, and got my first job, started saving money, and came home one day and said, Dad, I want to bring your car out of retirement and I want to race it.
Mm-hmm.
Volkswagens bring you together. I don't know why, but they bring you together. It's cool. I can't explain it, man. It's like a drug. Yeah, it's you know, some people do drag racing. That's their drug. This, you know, Volkswagens and dirt is our drug.
Para mí fue desde niño, desde que tenía 8 años. Mi papá empezó a correr en las bajas en 1969. La primera baja 500 él la corrió. Y no corrieron en un Volkswagen, corrieron en otro carro. Pero también corrieron en un 5600. Y pues yo aprendí a manejar un bocho. En bocho aprendí a manejar y hemos corrido en bocho siempre, ¿no?
Nací en un Volkswagen. Mi vida fue cotidiana en un Volkswagen. El carro de mi padre, de todos los días, su carro de uso para su trabajo era un Volkswagen, un Baja, 67, 66, que en el que se movía, íbamos a la Sierra de Juárez, íbamos a las carreras, me llevaba a la escuela. Mi vida entera era en un Volkswagen. A mí me sigue gustando Volkswagen. El sueño de todo corredor a lo mejor es manejar un trophy track. Pero para llegar a eso, el escalón que te permite manejar un carro de ese tipo, tienes que manejar un Volkswagen. No digo que no se pueda manejar un trophy track, un clase 1, un clase 10, otro carro más rápido, aunque nunca hayas manejado un Volkswagen. Pero si tú manejas un Volkswagen, vas a poder manejar cualquier carro.
I can tell it's a really tight, great community because I've helped a lot of those guys and those guys have stopped and helped me. I'm in like this 1,000 horsepower beast, and here's a guy in like a little 1600, comes, you need help, you need agua, you know, like water, whatever. And it's just, I don't think it's so much, the trophy truck's about racing and going fast, getting every bit of everything out of that truck. This is, I think class 11 is just surviving. And it's just, I think in the world of racing, you know, there's not, it's so brutal. And so, like, you know, there'll be like a silt off-road, off-camber hill that's like silt gravel and blah, 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 and I'm just like flying, trying to make it up there. And, you know, and then you'll see a class 11 car, they can make it up the same thing. Like, I don't want one less horsepower in the trophy truck, just like wringing its neck, trying to get up there. And here comes like a little 66 buck, and he'll make it up the same thing I can make it up. So it's like, that's a testament to the design and the durability of a VW.
I was born here in Ensenada in 1965, and my father was a news reporter. Well, since I remember, I was racing in my family or you know, being watching the race or watching the contingency of the start of the race. And, you know, I grew up wanting to be a racer. you know, I mean, professional racing, it's you know, way out of my league, but there was a way I wanted to be involved. And, you know, I say I want to be a mechanic and work on my race car that I had in the 80s. And now I, that take me to the other thing. You know, I started working on my car. I learned how to work on these transmissions and motors. And then I got involved. I said I've been working on this for 32 years now. This is where we work on the engines. Little different area. You know, we have a, this is how we start working on the engines. It's pretty clean. And then that's our, let me turn the lights on. We have a little engine dyno. You know, we usually, we always do check our engines on the dyno. We never let them go out without being checked. And, you know, this is what it looks like. Well, I used to have a backup bag to race, a 516 car, which is a pretty much a Volkswagen, cut-off Volkswagen. And in 1989, I started racing with it. But it's the car that represents the Baja, you know, it's the Baja bug, you know. And I grew up wanting to have one of those cars. And I raced with it for 2 or 3 years till I sold it. And this guy invited me to race in another type of vehicle, like Class 9, which is a Volkswagen, but just a two-wheeler car with a Volkswagen engine and stuff like that. But Bajas and Volkswagens are very much part of this sport. You know, they're like the very first cars that got to race Baja. And they, just by themselves, without making a lot of modifications to them, you can go and pre-run or, you know, at least go and cruise around Baja California desert.
Just a bat in a cave. Oh, I'm trying to behave, but there's so much blood and so many things. I can't wait for the sun to sing again. I'm just a hunting.
Like a cabra, we say in Spanish, because you can take the bug wherever you want. Trees, desert, beach, whatever. Huh? And that's why I love this kind of cars.
You know, the cars are just the conduit that bring us all together. It's not, you know, there's a lot to learn about the cars, certainly, and I've enjoyed that, all the little details from year to year and all the modifications that have been done over the years and, you know, who started what and what trend started where. And, you know, all of that has been really fascinating. But as I've ventured off into other car stuff and different scenes and stuff, every time I come back to the VW stuff, it just feels right. You know, the attitude of the people that are driving these old VWs is really chill. It's an approachable bunch of people. They're the pretense is gone. It's not like Corvette guys or Ferrari guys or anything like that. You know, it's not about what you've got. It's what you can bring to the community.
built that car, then I let that car, the boat wagon that I'm running now for the Nora, car 34, and let it sit for 30 years. And then a friend of mine came by and said, let's go run the Baja 1000. So, okay, well, that'll be all right. And so we kind of prepared the car, drove it a couple times in Texas to see how it did from 30 years ago. And everything is pretty fine, you know. So we brought it down here to Ensenada, started meeting all the people that love the Baja. And pretty soon we were in love with the Baja. To me, everybody that comes, they don't come to race to win a trophy or anything. They come to see their friends from all over the world, basically. And it's just so enjoyable here. And you get attached to it. Pretty soon somebody walks up, oh, I remember you last year. And that's one of the greatest things of racing the Baja. If you've never raced it, just come down 2 or 3 days in Sonata and see what goes on. And if you have a race car, whatever it is, I got an old 67 Volkswagen, and like I tell everybody, I just kind of tour along, you know. I don't run wide open to try to tear my car up. I just enjoy the Baja. And if you've never been to the Baja to see the cactus, the mountains, how beautiful it is here. It's not like any other deserts you've ever been to if you've never seen the Baja. And so that's kind of my story on running the Nora.
All right, John, you're not going to get it all off.
So here we are today at the Mexican 1000. After Dad passed away, I brought it back. I've been running it for 13 years now. We've got a lot of entries. We're having a good time. The key to this whole thing is, and why everybody's really having a good time, smiling, having fun, is because we didn't start this event with the idea of filling our pockets. We started it to finish something our dad started from our hearts, both Eliseo, which Eliseo's father was my dad's right-hand man. And Eliseo is my partner. And we started this from our hearts, and it's continuing on. We have communications with every race car right here. Every race car has a tracker on it, and we can see where everybody is. On the internet, on the screen, we can see where every helicopter is. We can see where every medical equipment is. We can see everybody on the course. We have a sweep team. We can see where they are. We can guide them, and we can talk to them through satellite communications, because we don't have cell coverage down here. Roy's got it all at his fingertips. You guys run the whole race. You run the whole thing. And I want to say thank you. Thank you again for what you do. And I'm just so impressed with the way you've got it together here. I'm having fun with it. We started with our hearts, and I can tell you, do what you think is fun, and it won't be like work.
Doesn't matter what place you finish. But finishing, you know, gives you a satisfaction that what you work on for a few months, you know, reflects it on your, you know, at the finish line. It's a Mexican funnel.
Pero
tú te entiendes en el alambrado, ¿no? No te preocupes, no falla. Espérate. Pásame un bote. Está bien, de hecho, echada a perder la gasolina.
¿Está bien qué?
Echada a perder la gasolina. Ok, dale.
¿Ya?
Dale. Even if it's going to be hell, you know, driving, it's going to get stuck, something is going to break. You know, you have to be concerned about the people being there to bring you the spare stuff. And, you know, it's a lot of logistics. Improve this one, we make different things on this car. This car is going to be pretty fast. It is pretty fast. And, you know, we change arms, we change shock positions, valving, transmission. We change a lot of stuff on this car. This car, you know, we upgraded this car. It's been racing since 1990. So it's been racing, you know, 32 years old.
Just got to Ensenada. We are fired up. The car's dialed. We're doing a little last minute things to get it fully prepped. Race is on Thursday. We couldn't be more stoked.
Yeah, we did a class one first, and then got into the spec truck in like 2015, and then raced that for couple years, and then we got into this, so definitely went backwards. Off-road dyslexia or something. So we had a 750 horse in the buggy to the spec truck, which is, you know, like whatever, 500 or to
no going backwards on
pretty decent bug motor. Tim won't tell me what it made. But it runs good. It runs pretty damn good.
You should put it on the lever.
So,
but
I always say over prepare and overachieve. So we definitely do that. We brought our, I guess you could say, our class 6100 mindset and just brought it to class 11. So and the team is just on point.
We got a good team, you know, a lot of experienced guys with us. We're not going to bring a UTV. We will bring trucks to, you know, help us move the vehicle. You know, and Uruapan is going to be tough. The mics is going to be very tough. We're going to mics, especially by the time we go there, everything is going to be moved. My old 200 to 220 is going to be a lot of silt, a lot of rocks. It's going to be loose. It's going to be an uphill. It's going to be bad. So it's going to be a fun, fast course. This is Baja races. This is class 11. Let's see what happens. Well, a class 11, you know, there's a lot of people that comes and goes. It's not like something that you race a trophy truck and somebody fixes a car for you, and then the car breaks in the middle of nowhere and you don't know what to do. You know, a class 11 driver needs to know the car completely, how to put it, you know, disassemble the vehicle, put it back together, MacGyver some of the stuff, you know, and that's what makes the class unique and different.
In 21, I think we started and had a bad showing, had a bunch of pulley issues, just very stupid stuff. And everyone's, you know, I could tell they're like, ah, you know, this guy's coming in, he thinks it's so easy, you know, and you know, like, we didn't have the best showing, and I'm like, man, what the hell, you know? So we regathered, you know, made some changes, and you know, came out at the 500 and won that. Went and won the 400. We're like, all right. So now we're on a roll.
Don't think that you could just go in and drive it. No, it doesn't work that way. You have to know the car completely.
And we talk about the trophy trucks and so many other classes, especially like the UTVs, a lot of them are four-wheel drive. This is hands down the toughest way around Baja course in a class 11.
I'm very nervous, you know, but as soon as that flag goes down, you know, you're enjoying your life. It's like a drug. Let's put it this way. Because you know that it's going to be a tough day. Or tough days sometimes, because you don't know what's going to happen. Every race is the same thing. So it's a different feeling, you know. You hear, you see the people and you see the flag going down, and then you're in heaven. That's what I can say.
Thank you.
coming into like mile marker 160, I missed a turn, came up onto an embankment, in first, lots of time, just being impatient and dumb, slammed it into reverse, which is a huge no-no, everybody knows that. Gear just disintegrates. I heard it and, you know, just pissed off even more. We dug and dug and dug and got ourselves out. And I think we were still first on the road, but the car wasn't going into first, or no, I think second and third. So it was like a slow limp in first. And then like when we could, we would shift it to fourth and try to get some momentum. But we limped it into a Pemex or an Oxo, mile marker 200. It was a sight to be seen. I mean, all hands on deck, car on jacks, all the chase trucks around us, all the locals surrounding us, pulled the motor, had the spare trans there. It was a wild 2 hours. And then seeing those cars go by, you know, you're falling back, falling back, falling back.
We had about an hour lead. The first two cars just passed, I think the Pollo Racing and the Spirit 2 car or something, but we still got, 1,000 miles to go? So we'll be back on the road in about an hour.
No problem.
Yep.
Just loosening up a little bit and try to keep it calm right now, then get into the, in the flow of the race and do the best navigation I can. Yeah, it is. It's going to be a long night.
Emocionado. Excited. Trying to do a mission impossible.
Hey, Sandy.
That's a bug. That's a moncho.
Sandy.
Desde ayer le dije, vamos, ¿por qué una WD-40 a la puerta y no le
pasa? Claro, estamos revisando.
¿Dónde está tu WD-40?
Ahí está,
ahí está. No, 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 no,
no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no,
¿Ya
está viniendo?
Sí.
Ok.
¿Y quién es este?
Hay que abrir la cajuela. Hay que abrir la cajuela. La llave 13, por favor. Una llave 13. Abrir la cajuela. Llave 13. Llave 13. Hay que levantar las luces. ¿Qué onda? ¿Venimos bien o más o menos?
Bien.
¿Sí?
Al puerto se pasó el otro.
Están corriendo arriba de todo. ¿Cuándo hubieras visto tanto tiempo?
Pásame la llave 13. Una pregunta. ¿Dónde está el Sámelo?
Sámelo.
Sámelo. Vamos a cuidar a los brincos, Toto. Va a ser como cruising. En la subida tiene un chingo de power. Hay que quitar la cajuela, por favor. Voy por tu por. Por.
7/16.
Brake cleaner? Brake cleaner?
7/16?
No, brake cleaner. Just brake cleaner.
Okay. Just for 11.
Yeah, so I can clean the link. Don't be back. Por favor, Pancho. Pancho. Ok, pásame el de 40.
Saca los lentes.
San Mano, acelérale y suéltale, acelérale y suéltale. Acelérale, a ver. Suéltale. Ya está devolviendo, ¿eh? Ya estuvo, ya estuvo.
Ahí están los lentes.
No, 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 le quería echar agua así. Vale, agua. Pedo. ¿Eh? Espérate.
¿Le quieres echar agua?
Sí.
Le hago un hoyito aquí. Le hago un hoyito aquí, Eric.
¿Sí?
Mételos al estuche, güey. ¿Quieres echarle agua?
Mételos al estuche. Va. A ver, ¿quién fue el que me ayudó a doblar esta madre hace rato?
Yo.
A ver, vamos a doblarlo, amigo. Otra, una, dos, tres. Una, dos, tres. Ok. Una, dos, tres. Ok. Vamos a levantar esto un poquito, poquitito. A ver, préndelas, préndelas. Quiero hacer para allá, a ver cómo alumbra. Hazte para allá, esa mano. Vamos a entrar esto de aquí, son.
Driving?
When we're chasing, we'll see you in the next pit.
Hey, this might be them. Watch out, Jeep!
Time. meters, change it to a shell shock vicious wreck. Well, that dog will be the death of me if they don't keep his bark in check. Well, I hope that pup is hungry for his human's taste and neck. Cause if my neighbor fails to find a peaceful remedy, I'm gonna feed my neighbor to that
Ahí vamos.
We got stuck really, really bad. Really deep. We had to get out. The door couldn't open, so it was a mission to get out. And somebody helped us. We got out. It's really bad. Really, really bad. He's doing a good job. Keeping it nonstop. So yeah, there it is. It's really gnarly over there, man. I haven't seen those silt bags, silts, the worst I've seen.
Well, you can guess the rest of what happened next, but be sure that pup is quiet. Yeah, I took him in, he's my new best friend. Can't deny it, he wags his tail, it never fails. When I feed him, it's a riot. He sure loves the flavor of my next door neighbor. This joy, you cannot buy it. Well, my neighbors failed to find a peaceful remedy. I had to feed my neighbors to that D.O.G. I said my neighbors failed to find a peaceful remedy. I had to feed my neighbors to that D.O.G. Neighbors to that D.O.G.
Seeing it now.
The war of attrition.
Yeah, whoever stays together wins. I hope they get it together though, man. I want to race them to the end. That'd be sick. Have both of us show up here at the same time. We're about 15 miles back. I think the leaders had like 30 miles on us. And now they seem to be both broke down here in San Ignacio. So we'll wait for our car and see what happens. But it's looking good. We might retake the lead again.
You know, we have like 400 and something miles to go. If we get lucky, you know, we will finish up tomorrow, probably, I don't know. We're not going to be, probably we'll use like 40, 45 hours if we get lucky. But it's looking pretty good. And if we win, we don't know, but we want to finish.
Yeah, it takes a lot to look like this.
Hopefully soon.
Hopefully right up your ass.
Right up your ass, motherfucker.
What are they doing? What are they doing?
We'll be right back.
Watching the tracker, obviously we're all staging along the highway trying to parallel these guys as they work their way to La Paz. There's 4 11 cars basically in the mix, all within a 12 mile radius, 15 mile radius. And the leader is currently 15 miles ahead of us, but stopped at 0.2 miles an hour. We were stuck a second ago.
0.2 mile an hour typically means you're like stuck trying to get out of some silt or sand or whatever it may be.
Yeah, you're just slowly moving.
So what race mile is he at?
So he's at 11:63.
What time is it?
It's 4:13 in the
morning. 4:13 a.m. We've been going at this since
41
two
hours.
Days ago at noon.
Yeah.
Okay, Baja 1000, 2021. Okay, so what race mile? So we're at race.
We're at 11:46.
We're at 11:46 moving. Okay, where's the leader at?
The leader is at 11:63. Oh, he's just started moving again.
At what?
7 miles an hour.
So he's moving again 7 miles an hour, yeah. So he got stuck.
So it's still dicey.
And then behind us, how many miles per hour?
26 miles an hour, and he is 4 miles behind us.
And there's another guy 4 miles behind us, so that we lost our comms. We have no communication with the guys.
All we know is what's going on the tracker.
Alex is gonna... It's gonna be interesting to see what happens when that guy catches him.
What he does.
And passes him. Because he's gonna sneak up on him and pass him. And then Solorzano, number 1111,
has been stopped. Oh no, he's moving again now too. He's going 30 miles an hour.
At what race mile?
It's not showing his race mile right now, but maybe
he's about,
10 miles
he's about
behind
10
us.
Miles back as well. So there's 4 11 cars
all around
over
1150.
Over 1100 miles into this race.
And what do you guys have to do to win the championship?
We have to finish.
We have to finish. If we DNF
and Solorzano finishes, then he takes it. If we both DNF, we take it. If we finish, we take it. So it's dicey. It's dicey right now for sure.
It's coming down to the wire.
To the wire, literally.
You would have never thought that when you started the race, 2 days later, it would be this tight.
Yeah, that's a fact. Let's get out of here.
You guys battled super hard. We were watching it like, how close were you? And I mean, did you guys touch at any point? That's what it looked like on the map.
I guess you could say we touched. I'm trying to remember the mile marker. I want to say by 9:10, we had caught up to him and we had actually passed him. And then that's when we started having electrical problems. He ended up getting back by us. We worked another 30-40 miles to get back to him, staying within, you know, half a mile. Ended up getting by him one more time just to have an electrical problem again. But yeah, I mean, it was good battling. It's a weird feeling to be this far into a race, something like the Baja 1000, and be battling that hard in a class 11.
I will, you know, trying to live.
Yeah, it was definitely a war. She whispered sweetly, "Can I see more?" Or was it the music that made me wish it was gone? And I'll never be the same. Yeah, no, respect the guy. King of Baja, definitely. I mean, he has so many wins under his belt. You know, but times change and you know, cars get better and you know, support gets better and whatnot. So, like I said, nothing but respect to the guy. He's probably the winningest driver in Class 11 in Baja. So, you know, and I'm sure it's tough for, you know, that the new guy to come in with, you know, whether it's better equipment or better planning or you know, better prep or what have you, you know, come in and do very well and you know, win the championship. So
it's hard, but it's life. If you want to go racing, you know, you have to pay the price, and that's what it is. And I hope this class doesn't die, or any of the vintage classes. You know, there's a lot of this could be a good turning point to start racing. That's a good advice. You know, if you want to know how to drive, this is the car you have to start. You know, if you start with the UTV, and you know, UTV, you can have errors and it's fine. And not in a Class 11. So I invite you people, build one and go race it.
Right there is my Class 11 build. It's been sitting in this exact spot for over 2 years, and I think it's time to bring her to life. As you can see, she's been tucked away in the corner, but she looks good. Full stock, 1969. Volkswagen Bug. Always been like a huge part of kind of my growing up. There was a picture of me and my mother in a Bug on our refrigerator up until I was about 16. And we kind of moved around when she had different like dudes that she dated. So
We moved around a little bit and that picture got lost in translation, and I wish I had a copy of it because it was something that I stared at, and it just kind of gave me that attachment growing up throughout my youth that bugs are the raddest thing ever. Shout out to my mom for being one of the hippies back in the day that had a bug that literally carved a career path for me today. It's been a dream for the last 6 years in the making. And this year we finally started it. Thousands and thousands of hours go into building these, and thousands of dollars. So, you know, liquidating my savings account and basically extending my resources to the full kill, the TT bugs are gonna be something that hopefully we'll be able to race against the trophy trucks. It's not a truck, it's not a sedan, or an SUV. It's a bug, and it has all the same attributes as the trophy trucks. Getting to line up against the big dogs has been a goal for many, many years, and seeing the TTs, that is, those are the elite top dogs in the sport. So being able to continue kind of my lifelong career path surrounding the bug at the top tier level with a bug was the only thing that made sense to me. So we're kind of running on hopes and dreams a little bit with that.
Stop!
I think everybody, they're so personal. Everybody's got a personal connection with one. Like my parents bought a new 67 Sahara Beige Beetle and then got a 71 Bay Window Bus. And so not only me, but probably you, everybody watching this, everybody has like a personal VW story. You know, air-cooled bug. Oh my God, we took that to my sister's in Oregon. And you know, everybody, they're just one of those vehicles that like people have been relentless with, which gives the car character. I don't know, they're just, I just a Volkswagen guy, even before a Harley guy. I had Volkswagens before I had Harleys, and I just have always loved them. And this little 69 I built is the first kind of, it's the first full-fendered Baja, but class 11 style I've ever built.
No matter what kind of press I'm in, the stress in my life, whatever, I just take that out. I sit in the driver's seat and I'm there then. A day does not go by where I'm not looking at VWs. Absolutely does not go by.
To move from Alaska to Oregon in a Volkswagen Bug, and my dad kept that car and it sat in our backyard forever. In the 80s, we had this group, we all had Baja Bugs, and we would take these cars, and in Oregon City, there was this hill down by the river, and you'd find some guy with a jacked up truck, and you know, you'd bet him that you could outclimb him on the hill. And the Baja Bugs, we were on Terra tires and all that, so we could climb these hills like nothing. We knew him. So you'd get a guy with a Ford F-250 or whatever, and he'd inevitably get stuck, and it was really cool if he had a hitch, because he'd go up, and then the hitch would stick right in the ground, so now he's stuck on the hill. And then we'd just roll and laugh, and so. That's kind of how it was.
Ganz lustig, wenn man sich so überlegt, dass das deutsche Auto eigentlich, oder dass der Trend rübergeschwappt ist nach Amerika, die dann wirklich alles Mögliche mit den Autos gemacht haben, ja auch Drag Racing und dann eben auch Rennen gefahren sind am Strand. Oder nur aus Spaß über den Strand gefahren oder durch die Wüste. Und dass der Trend dann wieder zurückgekommen ist nach Deutschland, ist schon ziemlich witzig.
First the Manx, then the Baja Bug. That they were in effect take a mass-produced platform and create something that it was never intended for, and in fact make it like a very capable tool. And it was all done by guys who, at the end of the day, the thing I love about customizing of any type and hot rodding is it's folk art, right? It comes out of just an ordinary guy with a good idea and a need to solve a problem. And I think that's the other fascinating thing about Baja Bugs is they're beautiful, right? They maintain the quirkiness of the VW Bug, which is one of the most popular designs of all time. But they created something that was very, very functional, but it wasn't ugly. It was, in some ways, it was even cuter, to use an awful word. But they had even more character than the original Bug, right? As soon as you crop those fenders, whether it's kind of like fenders, like headlamps in fenders, or whether it's a narrow eye, as soon as you crop that stuff off and tuck it all in and exaggerate the wheels, then the Baja Bug suddenly becomes a creature, right? It becomes more bug-like. When you see those things powering across the desert, like, and you see the articulation of the suspension, they've got a mind of their own. They look like they're actually like, they're a creature. And for me as a designer, the thing that I've always looked at is cars have faces, right? Cars have personality. We're losing that in modern car design, but there's no better example of a car having a face than a narrow eye Baja Bug. And then when you see it alive in its intended environment, the thing's just full of character. And I as a, whether it's a toy designer, a car designer, an artist, a creative, whatever that is, I think that's magical. And you can put bigger wheels and tires, and you can put a bigger motor in it, and you can put racks on the roof, and you can distort that. And even when you see the really extreme, the most extreme version of what a Baja Bug has become, it's still a Baja Bug. That profile still has character, and I think that's the enduring quality of a Baja Bug, right?
There's an attraction to Volkswagen. Like, you talk to Volkswagen people, and it's in their blood. It's like a part of their soul.
Yeah, man, I'm hooked, brother. Like, it's part of me. Even when I try to walk away, I can't. So, you know, I have a new baby at home, and I'm like, I gotta spend time with the baby. And it's like, oh man, I gotta go prep this car. And this is, I've had times where I'm in here with the pack and play, man, and I got her set up on the side, and I'm working on the car, and it's just me, my baby, and the bug. And that's it. And I can't get away.
Until you get in that car, and you put your hands on the steering wheel, and you take off and drive, you don't realize how much fun it is. And it just puts a smile on your face. And it's exciting, it's fun. It's not about the power. You're just in this fun little vehicle that I guarantee you'll have the time of your life. I grew up with Baja Bugs. I grew up with my dad racing a Class 11. And I grew up with all these stories. And it was funny, my dad was an inventor. He was a guy that could fix and build and do anything. And it was just when I saw him light up about racing Baja and this little Volkswagen and everything they did, it was just, I don't even know how to explain it, just so exciting.
My first time driving a car was at Pismo Beach. And my mom and I went back through the pictures. I was 5 years old, and I, you know, couldn't even see over the steering wheel, but we were all sitting around the camp, and my dad said, hey, you know, if you can start it, you can drive it. And that was all I needed to hear. And, you know, my mom gave me this pillow that I put behind my back, and I can still remember it just clear as day, little, you know, the original Baja Bug with paddle tires on it. And I don't think I got out of it all weekend. You know, it was just, you know, the feeling of being 5 years old and behind the wheel. And, you know, I couldn't even hardly see over the dash. And it was just from that point forward, man, I was hooked. It was like all I wanted to do.
This is a family of us. You know, it didn't start with me. It didn't start with my kid. It started with my uncle, and this has progressed. We are four generations deep into this now.
It's just not a lifestyle per se, it's just who we are, you know. It's burned into us, you know. It's what we do and what we'll always do.
A lot of people might look at it and just think, oh, it's just an old Volkswagen. But no, these Volkswagens, if they could talk, the stories, they could probably tell, you know. So I appreciate all the stories that are shared with me of people in their Volkswagens. And now we're in that club. We get to share our story. And again, I never thought I'd live that day, that I'd be the owner of a Volkswagen. Not only a Volkswagen, but a Baja racing car, a Class 11. So that's the beautiful thing about them. So what's your story?
Poor man, I'm the richest poor man ever.
I'm the richest poor man, poor man. I'm the richest poor man ever to roam.
See you tomorrow tonight.
See you tonight. I'll be ready. Hey, where are those headlamps?
They're good in the sky.
Oh,
so you can, hey, let me show you.
Three.
Here, no, here.